Now that we have covered encapsulation feature of object orientation, it's time to dig into the next very important feature, that is inheritance. Again, as usual, I'm going to have more of example oriented, but in this particular chapter, concepts are a lot what we have to understand. Why exactly is inheritance coming into picture? Then we will see how constructors are to be taken care of while doing inheritance. Then we will have parent-child relationship through references, how the casting has to be taken care of, what is static binding, dynamic binding. And finally, we are going to deal with an important topic called as abstract classes. So first, what is this inheritance? Now, in the introduction video, I have told you, whenever between two entities, we have got is a relationship, then inheritance comes into picture. Like few examples already demonstrated earlier, car is a vehicle. So car is a child class, vehicle is a parent class. Faculty is a person. Faculty would be child, person is a parent. So on with student is a person, mango is a fruit, chair is a furniture, scientific calculator is a calculator, and all these things. So let us start again with a new project where I am going to demonstrate or talk more about the syntax related issues. So let's take now a new project. C#, Windows Forms application, or we can take a simple console application now. Say inheritance demo app, click on OK. We'll get one basic skeleton class. Now I'll just want to delete these things. I don't want them right now, just to make it easy. So I write now a class, let's call it as parent class. Now how do we specify that the child class inherits the parent? Just say class child colon parent, and this is how the syntax goes. Now child inherits parent. Now what does child inherits parent means? Every member of the parent automatically becomes a member of the child class. Complete functionality of the parent automatically gets inherited by the child class. Now here, I am calling it as parent child, but many times you will see this is referred as base class, subclass, child class, all are fine. You can call it as parent class, super class, base class. Java programmers generally call it as super class. In .NET, preferably you might call it as base class. In child class, you can also call it as subclass. But parent child seems to be little easy to understand, and that's the reason I used parent and child as the class names, and absolutely no reason, no other reason. Now in parent class, let me have members. It can be public member, let's say PUBA. It can be a private member, or it can be a protected member. Now, right now I gave public for all. This I want to change it to private, and this I want to change it to protected. Now this is a new keyword for you. We already covered earlier public, private, protected. We will understand what is that. Now in child class also I would like to add one member, which I'll call it as PUBB. Now in child class, let me write a method. Let's say public void foo, some method. Now first question to you. When an object of child class is created, how many members are allocated memory? 4. Field members are allocated memory. That is, all the field members of the parent class and the member of the child class together are allocated memory as one unit. There is nothing like separation of parent and child. Basically, at runtime, you can say this is all merged into one single thing. So 4 members, public A, private A, protected A, public B, all 4 will be allocated memory together when an object of child class is created. Now, what is the difference between public, private and protected? Let's understand this. Only public members of the parent class and protected member of the parent class are accessible in the child class. See, we already know public members are accessible everywhere outside the class. Private members are accessible only within the class. They are not accessible outside the class. So what is this protected? protected is public in child, private in non-child classes. Public in derived classes, private in non-derived classes. That's how protected means. So here I cannot access private member, but I can access public, I can access protected, but I cannot access the private member. PRIA is not there in the list. I cannot set, I cannot get. Any private member of the parent is not accessible in the child because of its protection level. So this is one very clear point. So there will be some members in a class which even parent class wants to hide from the child class. Those will be private. But there are some members in the parent class which parent class want child class to see, but other classes should not see. Those members are protected members. Now, mind you, the mistake which many people do is, because this is private, they think this is not inherited. No, private has nothing to do with inheritance. Private only means access restriction. Memory is always allocated to that member. There is absolutely no doubt about it. Just have that clarification. Now, let us do something more. So, can I say all private members are not accessible if in the child class? True. But are protected members and public members accessible? Yes. Now, let's take a special case. Now, here in child class, for some reason, imagine I'm creating a variable of type child. Now, using C, can I access public member of class A? Yes. Using C, can I access protected member of class A? Yes. Both are accessible. But now, I create a variable which is of type parent and object is of type parent. Now, using P, can I access public member of parent? Yes. Using P, can I access protected member of parent? No. This is what is the special case. See what is happening. When I say protected member of a parent class is accessible in child class, what basically it means is you should go via child. So here when I do not write anything, it is as good as writing this dot, and same here it is as good as writing this dot. So this is what object of current class. Current is what child class. So through child we are able to access the protected member of parent in child class. C is what? Child class variable. So through child we are able to access the protected member of parent. But here what are we doing? Here we are trying to bypass child, and through parent we are trying to access protected member, and that is not allowed because protected member in parent is not directly accessible. Only via child it is accessible. A very important interview question. A protected member of the parent class is not accessible in child class if it is being accessed through a reference variable of type parent. But if it is accessed through a reference variable of type child, it is accessible. Have this clarity. Protected means you should go via child and then access. Bypassing it, it will not be allowed. So very, very, very important case. So this is one thing you have to remember now. So I believe protected is very clear. Now move on to the next thing. I delete this method now. So we have got four members in all in child class. Now let me first write constructor in parent class. So I'll give you a public class name which is parent, parameterless constructor. Then I will write public class name, and I would like to provide parameters for initialization of the field members. So shall I give three? Private A, integer protected A, integer public A. Three members are there in the class. So these three members I would like to initialize. So I write here private A, protected A, public A. Now we have got these two. Of course, we can also write copy constructor. I'm skipping it for the time being. Now it's the turn to write constructor in child class. Now in child class, public child class constructor name is supposed to be child class name, parameterless constructor, default constructor. Then I would like to provide a constructor with parameter. Now I have a question to you. How many parameters do you recommend for a child class constructor? In reply to this, most of the time the answer I get is maybe 3 or maybe 1. Many give 1 or maybe some will give 3. Now you would give 1 thinking that here there is only one member. But what about the parent class members? When object of child class is created, would we not want to initialize parent class members? And those people who think of parent class members also would give me answer as 3 but not 4, thinking that the protected, the private member of the parent is not accessible in the child, so how can we initialize, and they restrict themselves to only 3 parameters. No. Again, the same old point. Point is, when the object of child class is created, all the members of the child class and all the members of the parent class have to be initialized. Why only private, why only public or protected? Obviously, we would want to initialize private member also because it is allocated memory. All 4 members are allocated memory. When all 4 members are allocated memory, all 4 should be initialized. Yeah, the problem, the issue is private member is not accessible in the child class, for which we will have to find a solution. And we will. But should we not want, do we not want to provide value for all the 3? Rather, here we are giving private variable value. Through parent class constructor we are initializing, then why not through child class? So I would propose child class constructor should have all these things. I'll copy as it is, paste here, and it should have an extra one parameter, which is integer public for b. And here I would like to have that public b is equal to public b, and of course this problem is because of this extra bracket. So all this will go away. Yeah, the problem still remains. I want to initialize private member, but I am not able to access that private member in child class. And what is the solution to this? We'll see as we move forward. Let us comment it for the time being. So I repeat, we can provide all the possible constructors in the parent class, but at the time of providing constructor in the child class, do not restrict yourself to only that data which is accessible. Even include data which is not accessible from the parent class. And what is the solution for initializing that? We are yet to see. When the child class object is created, all these 4 members are allocated memory. So why not initialize all 4 of them? Obviously, we would want to initialize all 4 of them. So now, in main, I create an object of child class. C is equal to new child. This is one way I can create. And the other way we can create is 1, 2, 3, 4. 2 constructors we have in child class. Parameterless and parameterized constructor. So now let us trace the whole code. I'll put a breakpoint here. Run the program in debug mode. And use F11. Step into. So where will it go to? It will go to child class constructor. See, object of child class is created. Hence, it has gone to child class constructor. But even before it actually enters the child class constructor body implementation, you will see that from here, when I use F11 again, it will jump to the parent class default constructor. Parent class constructor does not have further parent to it. Now it will execute this. Then it will go down and continue the rest of the constructor of child class. So basically what I am trying to show you there is, whenever an object of child class is created, though it would visit the child class constructor first, it actually executes the parent class constructor first. It doesn't execute child class constructor before parent class constructor. Parent class constructor is always executed before child class constructor, and after parent class constructor, child class implementation would execute. This is understood. So order of execution of constructor is always parent and then child. Question is why? Why is that they have fixed the order of execution of parent class constructor and then child class constructor? No, it is nothing like object of parent will be created before object of child is created. Rather, I told you, because we have used here new only once, only one object will be created, and that is of child only. Because two constructors will execute, two objects will not get created. Because we have used new here, the object of child class is created. In the process, the execution of parent class constructor happens first and then child class constructor. Memory is allocated to all the four members together only as one unit only. Then where is the why is that parent first and then child? Simple reason. Imagine for some reason, if I give here PUB A is equal to 1 and if I give here PUB A is equal to 2, obviously after creation of the object here, if I put a breakpoint and trace, what do I expect? The value of object public member should be 1 or should it be 2? Obviously we expect it to be expected to be 2. Why not 1? We expect it to be 2 because child says it wants 2. So when will that happen? That would happen only if the child class constructor overrides what is done in the parent class constructor. So for letting the user to override what is already initialized in parent class, the order of execution is always parent class constructor executes first and then child class constructor. Child class would be able to override. Clear on this? Yes. Now let's put a breakpoint here. The second case. We'll trace it. Now again step into. It will jump to child class constructor. But before it executes child class constructor, it will execute parent class constructor. The value of this is 1. 2, 3, 4. But before it executes the rest of the code here, it will jump to parent class. Now question is, which constructor of parent class? This or this? By default, every child class constructor calls the default constructor of base class. So let me press F11 here. And you see now it went to parent class default constructor. It did not go here. So I repeat, every child class constructor by default implicitly calls the default constructor of the base class, the parameterless default constructor of the base class. If available, if we have written, fine. If we did not write, you already know, compiler would provide that. So yes, it will now execute that. Finished. Now it will come down and execute the rest of child class constructor. All the members are initialized out. But what is our requirement? My requirement would be, if only I can somehow from this child class constructor link it to this parent class constructor, we can have code reusability. Part of what is being done here is already being done here. Why should we repeat it? Yes, that is possible. We can actually write here colon base and pass the data to any one of the two constructors of the base class. So I am passing now private A, protected A and public A to base class constructor. Now let us trace it once again. Start. Jump. Now this is 1, 2, 3, 4 and that's how this is 1, 2, 3 now. This 1, 2, 3 now goes to the base class constructor. So 1 has come here, 2 has come here, 3 has come here. Now step into, 1 is initialized to private member A, 2 is initialized to private protected member A, and 3 is initialized to public member A. 1, 2, 3. So all the 3 members, private, protected, public, members of the base class are now taken care of in the base class, parent class here. Now going further down, you will see. Now, do we need this? Already it is initialized to 2 in the parent class itself. So, we don't need this anymore here. So, we can comment this code. Automatically, it goes to next line. Public A is also already initialized. Comment this also. Not required. It's taken care of in the base class. Public B, not yet initialized. This, we have to initialize it. So, just say step over. Step into. Out. So, are all the 4 members of child class initialized? Public B, which is in not yet assigned, we have to assign this to the left hand side. So step over. Now see 1, 2, 3 and 4 of child. All the 4 members got initialized. Of course, the tool here is showing separately base class and child class, but in memory they are all one single unit. So what is that we understood actually? See, the observation is simple observation. Did we solve that problem of private? It automatically got resolved. What we did is, whatever data we wanted to give to all the members of the child class, we captured here. Out of all the data, whatever data we wanted, we passed out to the parent class constructor. And parent class constructor took care of initializing its own members, leaving us in child class to only take care of the child class member. So parent class is doing its job, child class is extending by only initializing the extra member which is declared in the child class. So this is how, when we have parent class constructor and child class and constructor can pass data to the base class and ensure that it is taken care of here. So always I repeat one very important point. Whenever you are providing a constructor in the child class, ensure that you capture, you gather data not only for the members of child but also for the members of parent, including private. Point number two, child class constructor, if required, can pass data to the base class constructor using base. Letting parent class constructor to take care of initializing its own members, and then child class would only remain with initializing its own members. And this is the right approach for writing constructors in the parent class and child class. Now, I again repeat, whenever a child class object is created, the order of visiting is child class constructor first and then base class constructor. But the order of execution is base class constructor first and then child class. Now, why is it that the base class constructor is executing before child class constructor? Child class constructor would then have an opportunity to overwrite what is already done in the base class. But now the question is, why is that the order of visiting is child to parent? Simple. Only then child would be able to pass whatever data it likes to the parent. First this is visited and then this, it goes there and executes. So visiting order though is child to parent, execution order is very important, and that is parent and then child class. Now let me show you a typical case. What if I do not have a default constructor in the base class? Suppose, imagine if this is not there. So what is the impact of not having this method in the parent class? Obviously child class will give error, because by default we know that the child class constructor is calling default constructor of the base class. But here we have got base linked to another constructor, no problem. So now what is the choice we have? One solution you will give me is comment this out. Yeah, of course that will work. But I'll prefer writing here colon base 0, 0, 0. So what does this mean now? This basically means a child class constructor, if it is default constructor, not necessary it should call only default constructor of the base class. It can call any other constructor also. The rule is every child class constructor must explicitly link itself to at least one existing constructor in the base class. It can be by default default constructor, or it can be otherwise any other parameterized constructor. That is the basic rule. So I believe all these points are very clear about constructor. You have to keep in mind at the time of writing constructor in base class and child class. And these points, along with all the program which I have used for demo, is put up here. Compilation error because P is of type parent, and then these points, protected member are accessible only within the derived class. Everything I have told here clearly. Just please read it once again before you proceed further to the next chapter.